A very good morning and welcome to the 15th and final meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee for 2021. There are no apologies this morning. Can I please ask members and our guests to switch all mobile phones to silent and wait for the sound engineer to switch on your microphone before speaking. Our first item of business is the continuation of our consideration of evidence on efforts to improve the ways in which we prosecute violence against women and girls, and also how we support the survivors of such crimes. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2. I'm very pleased to welcome to today's meeting the Right Honourable Dorothy Bain QC, a Lord Advocate, and Mr David Harvey, Crown Agent and Chief Executive of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. So I'm going to allow up to an hour and a half for this evidence session this morning. Before we start, I just want to go over a few practical points. So this is obviously a fully virtual meeting, and I intend to use the chat function as our means of communicating. So if you do want to come in, if you can please type an R in the chat function and I'll bring you in if time allows. If we do lose connection at any point with a member or a key witness, I'll suspend the meeting and try and get them back into the meeting. And if we can't do that after a reasonable period of time, I will have to deem the member as not present and we will just carry on. If we lose connection to me, our deputy convener, Russell Finlay, will take over convening. And if we lose him too, then Rona Mackay will step in as our temporary convener with the committee's agreement. So please can everyone keep their questions and answers as succinct and as possible. And if that's all clear and there are no questions, we'll make a start. And I'd like to invite the Lord Advocate to make some brief opening remarks. Lord Advocate.
Thank you, convener. And I thank the committee for inviting me to this evidence session, for permitting me to give some opening remarks. I am appearing today with the Crown Agent, who is the professional head of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, Mr. David Harvey. Rightly, there is public concern over the number of rapes, sexual offences and crimes of violence against women and girls, and the response to that offending from the criminal justice system. The World Health Organization describes sexual violence against women as a major public health problem and a violation of women's human rights, which perpetuates gender inequality. Scotland has a lot to learn about attitudes towards women and the intolerable levels of sexual violence in society. There is a responsibility on all of us to do what we can to address these profound challenges. The volume of serious sexual offence cases indicted and awaiting trial was significant before the coronavirus situation. There has been a clear and obvious upward trend in these cases, which doubled in the 2 years up to March 2020 when trials were suspended. The pandemic has had significant consequences for the justice system, with increased delays in cases calling for trial and the uncertainty whether trials will proceed on a given day, causing anxiety and distress to victims and witnesses. There is a particular impact on the High Court, where, as of 30th September this year, 837 serious sexual offence cases were indicted and awaiting trial. This situation impacts disproportionately on female victims and witnesses. The range of issues raised, from the roots of these crimes due to the way they are dealt with by the justice system, requires a broad response, drawing upon a societal and political will to do better for our women and girls. Members of the committee have heard from victims and support agencies of what it means to be involved in the criminal justice system and the trauma that accompanies that. Scotland's prosecutors work with justice partners as we strive to ensure that victims are treated with dignity and respect. Furthermore, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service is committed to working with those partners to transform the way that the criminal justice system deals with these cases. As part of that commitment, I would like to inform the committee of two major initiatives within the Crown that I'm confident will deliver long-term improvements to the experience of victims and witnesses. Firstly, I have commissioned Suzanne Tanner, QC, to become Assistant Principal Crown Counsel and to conduct a full review of how prosecutors deal with reports of sexual offences. The remit of the review will be approved by me in due course and will take into account the views of victims and agencies from across the criminal justice system. It will build upon the existing specialist approach prosecutors have to sexual offence cases and the expertise they have in this work. Since becoming Lord Advocate 6 months ago now, I have had important conversations with the senior prosecutors in the Crown Office and Prosecutor Fiscal Service on how sexual offence cases are prepared and presented in court. I have been impressed by their dedication to improving the experience of complainers in these cases, and this review will support them in that ambition to improve. I am delighted that Suzanne is taking forward this crucial work, and I am confident that she will make a significant contribution. Secondly, the changing profile of prosecution casework and the backlog created by the pandemic have placed huge pressures on the Crown's victim information staff. I'm pleased to announce that the Deputy Crown Agent, Lindsay Miller, will lead a review of this work to ensure that the service can continue to deliver the high levels of support and advice to all victims and witnesses that they do currently. While this is a long-term programme of work, any measures identified by the review which could assist in the delivery of victim information services will be put in place in the interim while the review is ongoing. These are two of the steps being taken, and I'm determined that the part of the prosecution service I have responsibility for does everything it can to improve for people it serves. These steps are being made in the wider context of change and challenge. The Crown Office has received a satisfactory financial settlement from the government this year, and the committee's views in this budget report are noted and most welcome. The processes of increasing capacity of recruitment and training are underway. The planning for how to develop and improve the prosecution service is kept under review to ensure goals are realistic as the pandemic develops. Improving the experience of women in the justice system is something Scotland's prosecutors and their work partners endeavour to do every day. To make further improvements possible, some of the steps that may require consideration, for example, the implementation of the Lord Justice Clerk's review, improving the management of sexual offences, will require extensive consultation and careful consideration, and ultimately necessitate the elected members of the Scottish Parliament to make decisions that will have a profound impact on the way in which Scotland's justice system deals with serious sexual offences cases in the future. And so the Crown Agent and I will be happy to elaborate on the services plans in this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lord Advocate, for that very, very helpful and welcome update. So we'll now move on to questions. And if I may, I would like to open up with a fairly general question. So you'll be aware that a key focus of our work so far this session has obviously been to really understand the experiences of complainers and witnesses as they journey through the criminal justice system following an allegation of rape or sexual assault. And as part of our work, we've heard firsthand from a number of brave women on their experiences in that regard. And this morning, we'd like to really pick up on some of their testimony. And if I may start off by referring to Lady Dorian's review that you mentioned a moment ago on the management of sexual offences. And I'd like to ask a little bit about what actions the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service have taken to date in response to Lady Dorian's recommendations, bearing in mind that the report was published coming up for a year ago. So it was really just to ask for a broad update in respect of your response.
Yes, so, Convener, you will appreciate that I took up office 6 months ago, and that was sometime after Lady Doreen's review was published. And so perhaps the best way to deal with this is to see what I have done following on my appointment. Perhaps then we can add to that equation what the Crown Agent can assist with in terms of other information. I think it's important to put some of Lady Doreen's review in perspective insofar as my own involvement in the prosecution of sexual crime is concerned. In 2008, at that time, I was commissioned by the then Lord Advocate, Hailish Angelini, to report on and make recommendations on the prosecution of sex crimes in Scotland. And that outcome led to the formation of Scotland's National Sex Crimes Unit. That was 12 years ago now. And in that time, the challenges faced by the Crown Office in the prosecution of sexual crime and domestic violence has changed. The main change being the significant increase in the reports that the Crown receive through the police and the proportion of work that it makes up, both in the High Court and the Sheriff Courts. However, I see that the principles that underpin the creation of the National Sex Crimes Unit remain good today. And many of those principles are reflected in the recommendations in Lady Doreen's report that do not require legislative change. So in that respect, I refer to support for victims and witnesses in these very difficult cases, dedicated training in these matters for the lawyers undertaking the work, the importance of advocate deputy meeting in the High Court with victims of sexual crime pre-trial, as with the pocket fiscal deputies in the Sheriff Courts dealing with these cases on indictment. But in addition to that, I also see much of what I recommended at that time still being relevant. That is sound marking of these difficult cases. That is a decision taken to proceed or not, with specialism being brought to bear in the assessment of prosecutorial decisions and the way in which complainers are supported and the way in which those prosecute these cases conduct them. At that time, and indeed until I left the Crown Office in 2011, there was the standing instruction for specialism to be brought to bear in these cases. Standing instruction that advocate deputies met complainers well in advance of cases, and that there was particular training given to advocate deputies in order to provide them with the necessary skills to assist complainers to give their evidence in court. And I myself had direct experience in many cases of doing just that, where I found my own personal commitment and my professional contribution to the prosecution of these difficult cases was enhanced by the fact that I met these vulnerable people well in advance of the trial, spent time with them to give the necessary support they needed, that gave them the confidence and the ability to come into court with a screen and to give sound, compelling and powerful evidence that often resulted in a conviction in these very difficult cases. So what I don't know is why it might be that some of the principles that underpinned the creation of the National Sex Crimes Unit perhaps didn't continue after I left the Crown in 2011. I don't think it was because of a lack of ambition to do the cases well. I suspect much of it is to do with the volume of casework and the increasing complexity of that casework and the challenges that the COVID pandemic has brought. So I see that the review that's been done by Suzanne Tanner QC will reflect on what we did previously in the formation of the National Sex Crimes Unit and bring all of the principles that were identified as necessary and as reflected in Lady Doreen's report to the situation that we have today and deliver, along with me, the sort of prosecution service that Lady Doreen's review championed and one that I would very much welcome and want to be very much part of. So perhaps the Crown Agent could fill the convener in with what happened between my departure and my return just 6 months ago.
Thanks very much, Lord Advocate. Mr. Harvey, do you want to come in at all?
I'll come in very briefly, Convener, if I may. So I suppose a number of points, but I'll just touch on them since I suspect these are matters that we might return to. So the first point is the point the Lord Advocate was making towards the end there about the change in the profile of the High Court caseload. There is no doubt that over that 10-year period it did change dramatically, and the committee has heard the realities of that in terms of it now being 70% of the casework that is indicted into the High Court, which is a frankly very dramatic shift over the period of that decade. And it speaks to a range of things in terms of investigative and prosecutorial approaches, but also continuing issues at a societal level that I hope we'll have an opportunity to touch on. Insofar as your key question is concerned, Convener, in relation to steps being taken in the meantime to implement elements of the Lord Justice Clerk's review, those are being taken forward collectively, as you would expect. So there are things that are for prosecutors, but because it's system, it needs to be taken forward collectively. So, for example, the key element in the review about the presumption in favour of pre-recording complainers' evidence in serious cases is gathering momentum. Evidence and commission hearings are assigned on an almost daily basis now for the High Court, which is, in contrast to 2 years ago, a very, very significant change. The recommendation in relation to visually recording evidence of complainers at the start with video recorded interviews, that's at a pilot phase. And we are waiting cases coming through, 19 of those cases involving video recorded interview at the inception of the case have been indicted, and we anticipate that those will start to come through for trial, which will enable evaluation at that stage. And then separately, in light of developments in case law and also with the Lord Justice Clerk's review, there have been changes to Crown policy in relation to the intimation to complainers about applications in terms of Section 275 of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act, in relation to their rights and their opportunities to ensure that they are separately represented when it comes to issues in and around access to their records. So those are just three examples of matters that are being taken forward in the interim.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful. And you're right. I'm sure that we will come on to some of those issues and others throughout the session. So I will I'll bring in other members now, and I think we'd like to move on to some questions around not proven and judge-only trials. And I'll bring in Russell Finlay, followed by Katie Clark. So Russell, over to you.
Yes, good morning, Lord Advocate and Mr. Hardy. It's interesting to hear that 70% of High Court cases are now of a sexual nature, and how these disproportionately impact on female victims. In a recent interview, Lord Advocate, you suggested that sex crimes require a different and distinctive approach. Can you explain what you would like that to be, please?
I think that much of what I was referring to there is reflected in Lady Doreen's review. And the reason that I said that it requires a different and distinct approach is because of the particular nature of the crime and the particular impact that that has on individuals who are the victims of these crimes. We know that the World Health Organization in particular has identified that the nature of these offences are very problematic, and they perpetuate gender inequality, and these particular types of crime have an impact on society widely, and these types of crime impact on women's human rights. And if we are to do something about these issues, then we require to look at the nature of this type of offending with great care. And when we do that, we see that victims who are the victims of sexual crime have a very powerful response to the fact that they have been sexually abused, and their personal integrity has been impacted upon. It has a particular effect on the mental health of individuals, and it has life-enduring consequences for individuals. We see that because we can see that readily just by virtue of the fact of all of the work that Lady Smith's inquiry has done. Just reading through the reports of her work, we can see the profound impact that sexual offending has had on people as children, that's left them scarred for the rest of their life and makes it very difficult for them to, in later life, sustain relationships, engage in society at a good level in terms of an ability to progress at work. It often leads them to offending in their own right because they have struggles with mental health issues and they have struggles with drug addiction and alcohol addiction. And so we know that the very nature of the offence is very, very damaging. And because of that, I say we need to look at it with care. And because of the impact that it has on society at large, we need to look at it with care. So we need to ensure that the victims of these crimes are properly supported and ensure that as a proportion of our society, that they are given equal access to justice. And I'm supported in that requirement, that ask rather, for specialisation, for a distinct approach by many expert writers in the field and indeed by the European Court of Human Rights and by our own appeal court here. So that's what I ask for, because of the nature of the offence, because of the impact of it and the lifelong scars it leaves, it should be looked at differently.
In respect of judge-only trials, there's strong resistance from criminal defence lawyers. One concern is that instead of a jury of peers trying somebody, the accused would be in front of a usually male, white, middle-aged, privately educated lawyer. What would you say to that specific concern and those lawyers who are very vocal about this issue? Are you trying to persuade them? And finally, a sort of three-part question, I suppose, is there any evidence that you've seen in the profession of this being a male-female split in respect of this view, given that this is relating primarily to crimes of a sexual nature? Thank you.
I suppose that I would like to answer that question, Mr. Finlay, not by saying that I'm trying to persuade. What I'm trying to do is, as the head of the prosecution system in Scotland, bring to the committee and bring to the public at large, if I possibly can, the issues in and around these particular types of cases. And I do so at this stage because, obviously, I've been invited to do so. We have the Lord Justice Clerk's review and we have the backlog and the problem that that's causing in the prosecution of these very difficult cases. What I think is important is to understand that what I'm saying comes on the back of one of the recommendations in Lady Dorian's review, which is for a limited pilot, limited in time, of single judge rape trials to ascertain their effectiveness and how they're perceived by complainers, accused and lawyers, and to enable the issues around this to be assessed in a practical rather than a theoretical way. Now, that was a recommendation of the review, and that recommendation is rooted in the fact that the review explained in detail that for many years there's been a lower conviction rate for these cases than any other type of crime. And from this, the review identified a demonstrable inequality and a lack of justice for a particular group within society. The review stated that there was public disquiet about that. And the review said that the conviction rate for rape and attempted rape has been the lowest of all crimes in each of the last 10 years. All crimes. So they said that the review said the figures couldn't be ignored. The disparity was such that it couldn't be explained by poor prosecutorial decision making, and the disparity was such that it couldn't be explained by the fact that the victims, predominantly women and girls, are not capable of being believed. So the review legitimately asked by this question that those who all have a responsibility for the prosecution of sexual crime, is the system of justice failing to provide justice? Is there genuinely a perceived lack of justice were the victims of sexual crime. The review said that that's not unique to Scotland, and the statistics that we are concerned with are raised in all corners of the United Kingdom and in New Zealand. And so what the review says is that they've identified a problem that may be remedied in a particular way. So ultimately, as the independent head of the prosecution system in Scotland, it would be fundamentally wrong for me to reject the Lord Justice Clerk's reasoned and rational recommendations, because all that she seeks to do is to further explore a possible method of dealing with a seemingly intractable problem that results in an erosion of the public confidence in our system of justice. So I support the review, but it is, as I state at the outset, for the democratically elected members of Parliament to give effect to any or all of that. And I support the review because any modern progressive prosecution system must be inclusive and must uphold equality and equality before the law. And indeed, that's one of the guiding principles of law, that's justice and fairness. So if there's a way, if it is legitimately the case, as identified by the review, that there's public disquiet over a failure to deliver justice for a particular group of our society, and as the head of the prosecution service, I would ask that that review is considered. I would ask that parliamentarians take on board what the review says, and I would ask that there's a debate informed by all members of society, all members of the legal community, in order to form our elected representatives of what might be the right way forward. That's all I'm seeking to do. I'm not looking to proceed one way or other, but I'm pointing out that a review has said that justice may not be delivered to a group of our society, and I think as head of the prosecution service, I have a responsibility to react to that.
Thank you. Separate to that, but connected, is the issue of not proven. Do you have a view on whether not proven should be scrapped? Or do you also have a view on whether, instead of guilty and not guilty, the two verdicts should be proven and not proven?
So what I would say to that, Mr. Findlay, is that I and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service will consider any proposal coming from the forthcoming Scottish Government public consideration and consultation on this verdict and the abolition of the requirement also of corroboration. These matters, though, cannot be considered in isolation, and consideration will require to be given whether or not they should be accompanied by other safeguards. The detail and interconnectedness of any elements of any proposal will be critical. So I, as head of the prosecution service, look forward to receiving the outcome of the consultation, and I will react to any decision that's made by Parliament in that regard appropriately. It's not for me to express a personal view as the head of the prosecution service.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. If that's you finished, Russell, I'll bring in Katie Clark, followed by Jamie Green. Over to you,
thank
Katie.
Thank you. Good morning. And Lord Advocate, you've been very clear in your support for a time-limited pilot in relation to single judge rape trials. One of the other suggestions is that there could be more training or support for juries. Is that something that you've given any thought to? And what do you think that might look like?
Something that was explored in Lady Dorian's review, and there was some concern over whether or not that could actually be delivered. I've also seen some discussion of that in expert papers, and indeed some views on that from expert psychologists who've looked at the jury system and who've identified that rape myths and the belief in these can negatively impact on a jury's decision in terms of guilty or not guilty. So I understand, Ms. Clark, the point that you make. What I think the review has recommended is there's better directions, clearer directions to the jury, that there's better direction and clearer directions given over noting of the evidence. And These are all things that can no doubt assist. Over and above that, I would honestly say I haven't given it any further thoughts, but anything that can assist a jury's understanding of the rape myths and the negative impact they have on the decision making of a jury and the unfairness that they may bring about in the jury's decision making would be a very good thing, because there has been evidence-based reviews that demonstrated that that does exist. And if they're to be assisted in a way in which they see their way through the evidence and come to the decisions that they require to come to in these difficult cases, then I'm very supportive of that. And indeed, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service would assist in any work that was needed to be done in that with the judiciary and the Judicial Institute and other parts of the profession.
That's very helpful, thank you. And in relation to not proven, there is a suggestion, and I think you've already said that that perhaps could be linked to other changes in the system. So if there was a decision to move towards a two verdict position, do you think that other changes are essential? And if so, perhaps could you outline in more detail what they might be? For example, one of the suggestions that has been made is that there should be a change in jury majorities. Do you think that would be a necessary condition? And what other aspects of the justice system do you think we would need to look at as well as the verdict if this was something that was being given live consideration?
I think I've made my position clear on the not proven verdict, that I require to await the outcome of the consultation. I understand that this consultation on not proven corroboration is also to take place in and alongside the work that's been done on Lady Dorian's review by the Governance Review Group. And in addition to that, there will be a consultation process on Lady Dorian's review. The justice system is such that all of these issues are interconnected. And so if you alter one aspect of the system, it's essential that we take great care to explore what impact that has on other parts of the system. And so all I would say, Ms. Clark, is that if there's a change to the verdicts, there has to be a consideration as to whether or not that impacts on jury size and jury majorities. And it also has to look at as to whether or not the rules of corroboration are relevant, and indeed whether or not ultimately these issues might impact on the decision that might be made in relation to the best way to prosecute cases of sexual violence and the best way in which to ensure that justice is served in these cases.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I think Russell Findlay would like to come back in, and then I'll hand back over to Jamie Green, followed by Rona Mackay. So, Russell, do you want to come back in?
Sorry, I didn't indicate that, but no.
Okay, apologies. I thought you'd indicated. Apologies.
Sorry.
In that case, I'll bring in Jamie Green, followed by Rona Mackay. Jamie.
Thank you, convener. I hope everyone can hear me okay, despite my earlier technical difficulties. And good morning to the Lord Advocate. Thank you for appearing with us today. I think much of what I was going to ask has been covered in the initial two questions, but I thought maybe I would just pick up on another point, and that's based on the evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary that we had last week, which I'm sure you saw or indeed read the transcript of. And I was quite struck by many of the answers by the Cabinet Secretary, which implied that any such changes, fundamental changes to the legal system, whether it's corroboration, whether it's juryless trials, removal of not proven, changes to jury sizes and majorities, etc., etc., it was quite clear that these were matters for the Lord Advocate, not for him to comment on as the Cabinet Secretary. So I guess what I'm trying to get to the bottom of is, in your answers, you seem to imply that these are political decisions or matters for parliamentarians, politicians, not for the Crown, but the politicians are saying these are matters for the Crown. So really, where do you think the buck will lie with some of these decisions, some of these very difficult and indeed controversial decisions?
So, Mr. Green, in relation to, for example, if we take the question of a pilot, a time-limited pilot for juries, the review that Lady Dorian did was very clear that there was a strong historical and emotional attachment to trial by jury, and that valid arguments in favour of the democratic benefit of community involvement were strong. But the review also said there were very strong arguments in favour of conducting trials in other ways, and said this, that the traditional arguments in favour of juries were met equally by compelling arguments for judge by trial alone, which cannot be left unexamined and ignored. So Lady Dorian's review identified this issue because they identified that there was an area within society that there was a question as to whether or not we were delivering justice for a particular group. Now, as the head of the prosecution service, as the independent head of the prosecution service, this troubles me, as does the low conviction rates, for good reason. It would be irresponsible for me to not have concern about it. But ultimately, the decision as to whether or not the change that requires to be made in order to legislate for a pilot, for a time-limited pilot for judge-only trials, in order to understand whether or not Lady Dorian's review was correct in its assessment, and indeed how that might be examined and looked at a later date in order to inform better our understanding and whether or not genuinely we can make things better for this particularly vulnerable group of people, then that's what we want to achieve. But the only way to achieve that is by legislative change. And legislative change is for the government and for the elected members of the Scottish Parliament to decide on. I can only give my views as the head of the independent head of the prosecution service. As I do, I can only say that I would like a really strong, properly informed debate over this critical issue. But change is not for me, it's for you and all the other members of the Scottish Parliament elected by the people of Scotland, who I'm sure want a criminal justice system that delivers for everybody and that's consistent with the rule of law. Because the rule of law requires that the criminal justice system serves every member of society, not just one section of it. So, and everybody has to feel confident that the law is there for them if they need it.
That's helpful. I might come back to you on that in a second, but I believe the Crown Agent wants to comment as well.
Thank you, Mr. Green.
Mr. Harvey, do you want to come in?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Very briefly again, as the Lord Advocate says, this requires a legislative fix if we were to go down this route, but there's another more fundamental point here. It's not just rule of law, it's about equality. And there are obligations on the state, there are obligations on Scotland that parliamentarians have a role to play on. So I suppose, if I might just look back, one moment to Mr. Finlay's question about whether there was a male-female split in any way, shape or form, and I chose not to come in at that stage rather than interrupt the flow. But there is absolutely no doubt that the current situation is having a disproportionate impact on women and girls. It's clear. And men need to own that problem and also the solution. And that comes back to the broader societal point, but also is relevant for the purposes of the professional response. I was involved at the very inception of the Lord Justice Clerk's review, and there are a number of very significant recommendations in that, beyond those that are obviously the headline ones in relation to independent legal representation, in relation to victim advocacy, in relation to single points of access, etc. And Members will recall that the Lord Justice Clerk's review was very clear in starting with a blank sheet of paper. Being no doubt, that blank sheet of paper is, you wouldn't start from here. You would not start with where we are. And that is why the proposals and the review are as they are, because what we need is a shift, not only in terms of the way in which we are dealing with these cases and the way in which we're supporting people through the system, but also separately and more broadly challenging the behaviours that underlie the need for these changes in the first place. So I thought it would be helpful to pick up on Mr Finlay's point, but also in relation to Mr Green's point, the key elements here are, from my perspective, leadership across the board, whether that's political, prosecutorial, judicial or otherwise, and we've had some judicial leadership here in making recommendations that are well informed, that follow consultation with a range of individuals, including experts in the system, and I would commend the report to the committee.
Thank you. Could I possibly respond to what we've just heard?
Yes, of course, go on, Jamie.
I do appreciate that. Thank you, convener. So, there's very little to disagree with in what I've heard from previous two answers. This is a collective problem, but what I'm trying to get to the nub of is what happens next, because that to me is still unclear. And the reason I raise it is because I listened with great intent to the language used by the Cabinet Secretary, who represents the government and indeed sits in the Parliament, about how we could take forward change, quite significant changes. Now, whether they're trials or whether they are more permanent changes, I do appreciate that they will require legislative change, but it's whether the legislative change is just simply a technical requirement to enable that change to happen, or whether it's the legislative change which informs the change itself. And the Cabinet Secretary went to great lengths when asked about, for example, trials to juryless trials or other such changes, that these would be matters for the Lord Advocate. So what I'm trying to get at is, are you, Lord Advocate, advising the government as to what sort of changes it should be introducing through legislation, of which the Parliament will debate and vote on? We will all do that as individual members. Or are you looking to the Parliament to come back with a set of proposals that you are then forced to introduce as the Lord Advocate?
So I am the head of the system of prosecution of crime in Scotland, and that's a constitutional position that I hold, independent of the government. And my response to what you described, Mr. Green, is to say, legislative change is for the Parliament, it's for the government of the day, or indeed in relation to individual parliamentarians to bring forward their own bills in order to debate the issues that they have concerns in and around. And I think, as I understand it, that you have your own personal bill that you're bringing forward because of your concern in and around so many of the issues that we will be touching upon today. I think I can't be any more clear than that I read Lady Dorian's review. I deal day and daily with the consequences of the pandemic and the impact that it has on the prosecution of sexual crime and indeed other crime. I want to have a prosecution system that is progressive, humane and delivers for all sections of society. And I say what I say in relation to sexual offences in the hope that people will listen to me and understand that I do see that we have problems, and I do see that some other people who have conducted expert reviews that were informed by experts in the field and very eminent and senior members of the judiciary have identified that there is a possibility, a real possibility, that a section of our community are not properly being served by the justice system. And they're looking to remedy that, and they've made recommendations in and around that. And so As the independent head of the prosecution system, it would be fundamentally wrong for me to reject the Lord Justice Clerk's reasoned and rational recommendations, because all that she seeks to do is to further explore a possible method of dealing with a seemingly intractable problem that results in an erosion of public confidence in our system of justice. And it's a problem that's been with us for a long, long time, and we cannot allow it to go on for another 40 years. We've got to do something about it. And I think whether as head of the prosecution service or a person that you'd meet on the street, any reasonable person would agree with that. But fundamentally, all I can say, Mr Green, is legislative change is for the legislature. As an independent prosecutor, that's all I can do. I can't say any more than I've said. But perhaps the Crown Agent could also come in here.
I think he's just dropped off the call, but I do appreciate your second response on that. Convener, I'll have to come back later. I have some other questions, so happy to reserve those for later in the session.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay, and then we will move on to our next area of questioning around the role of Advocate Deputy. So over to you, Rona.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Lord Advocate. In a recent interview, you said judge-led trials don't impact on the right to a fair trial, but we need to look at the suitability of a jury to prosecute a case. And you added, we should be properly informed about judges. You'll know that Professor Fiona Leverick's research found overwhelming evidence that jurors hold prejudicial and false beliefs. We certainly heard in our private evidence sessions with victims that they felt there was an element of that quite often, they felt the jury might have been prejudiced if the complainer had been drinking, etc. So I just wanted to ask your opinion on that and what you actually mean by the suitability of a jury. And does that mean sort of media training? And I refer particularly to specialist courts.
Thank you, Ms. Mackay, for your question. In that interview that I gave to the Holyrood magazine, the major purpose behind it was to seek to engender a well-informed, reasonable, balanced debate over what is a critically important issue to the prosecution of crime in Scotland. I wasn't pursuing a personal agenda. I was hoping to engage with others in order to encourage them to take part in a debate that's properly informed, reasonable, and takes account of all viewpoints across society. That's the purpose behind the magazine article. In relation to the point that I made about we need to look at whether or not juries are appropriate to prosecute these cases and return verdicts in these cases, that reference was made by me as a result of part of what was contained in Lady Dorian's review, which, because of what she looked at along with others, and because of the expert evidence that she looked at, and she looked at qualitative and quantitative expert review and work, in fact she looked at the work done by Fiona Leverick, that there was a question mark as to whether or not juries were in fact suited for this particular type of case. And it was highlighted that the Law Commission in New Zealand actually concluded that they weren't suitable for these types of cases because of attitudes towards rape victims in relation to, for example, beliefs that blame the victim and the survivor, beliefs that cast doubt on their allegations, beliefs that excuse the accused, and beliefs about what a real rape looks like. And it was recognised by Fiona Leverick that these beliefs demonstrably showed overwhelming evidence that juries just weren't returning verdicts on the basis of the evidence before them. They were too influenced by rape myths. So Lady Dorian's review asks for that to be looked at. She says, and others say, we need to consider whether or not a particular proportion of our society is getting justice. There's evidence that it's not, and there's evidence that supports that from all of these people that we talked about, Fiona Leverick and the like. So all I ask is this, that Lady Doreen's review is looked at. We question legitimately whether or not juries are the right way to proceed with these very difficult cases. And in that context then, the question has to be asked as to whether or not there is a right to trial by jury in Scotland. Is there a constitutional right in the way that is reflected in the English system? And that the situation in Scotland is very different. There is no historic right to a trial by jury, and whether a case proceeds to trial by jury is determined by the prosecutor and the statutory provisions governing the relevant crime. So if the question was, is there a constitutional bar to trial by judge alone, there's not such a constitutional bar. I ask then, we should have a debate in and around all of these issues in order to answer the legitimate question raised by the review, which I repeat again, it's whether or not there's a proportion of our society that's just not getting justice. The conviction rate cannot be ignored and cannot be explained away by the fact that women just can't be believed. And the conviction rate in these types of crime is way lower than any other type of crime, and something has to be looked at in order to address this issue.
Rona, I think we lost Rona momentarily. I think she's maybe back. Rona, can you hear us? Rona, can you hear us? No, we're obviously still having some problems. So thank you for that, Lord Advocate. What I'll do is I'll move on to our next area of questioning, and hopefully we can get Rona back in and just confirm if she's got any follow-up questions. And can I just remind everybody to, if we're possible, keep questions and responses succinct. So we're now going to move on to some questions around the role of the Advocate Depute, and I'll bring in Colette Stevenson, followed by Pauline McNeill. So over to you, Colette.
Okay, thanks, Convener, and good morning, Lord Advocate and Mr Harvey as well. As the Convener alluded to, we obviously had really powerful contributions from survivors in our previous sessions. And I really just wanted to look at the role of the Advocate Depute. There was various statements made, such as going through that whole system was like a second violation. And I really just wanted to touch upon when it goes to prosecution, some of the way in which the statements were taken. In some instances, there's like fourth and fifth statements, and then when they actually got to the prosecution element of it, the statement was completely wrong in comparison to what they provided, and it was over years. I just really wanted to sort of ask you, you know, if that is a standard practice, in which case, why is that the case?
Stevenson, so in relation to the question of statements given to the police by complainers, which is what I think that you're referring to, the police officers who are investigating the crime are responsible for taking police statements from complainers, and those form the basis upon which an assessment is made by the prosecution service as to whether or not a case proceeds to trial. Because from the detail of the complainer's statements and the other report made by the police in relation to any particular offence that's reported, we look to the statement of the complainer and the surrounding evidence to identify whether or not there's sufficient evidence and law to prosecute and whether or not the case should be taken forward. The complainer's statements are productions in any trial, and these are disclosed in the disclosure process to an accused's representatives before a trial. And you will appreciate that what a complainer said in her first statement or second statement, that is something that's looked at with care by the accused counsel in order to look at whether or not the evidence given before the court or before commission is consistent with the statement originally given by the police. These statements are productions in the case, and the way in which I require advocate deputies to approach a case of this type is in the preparation phase of the case, to read all of the statements given by a complainer, to know these inside out, and then arrange for the complainer to see the statement before her trial, in good time before the trial, so that she can read, or he can read the statement in a quiet space and in a relaxed period of time, and understand what she said previously to the police. If there are issues in and around that statement, then I would hope that that would be raised by the advocate deputy with the procure fiscal or the advocate deputy responsible for the conduct of the case at that stage. But I should say that prior to the advocate deputy being given the trial for court, there is the process during which that the case preparer and the procure fiscal considers the complainer's statements, and there are opportunities for in that period of time to speak with the complainer and to discuss the case with her and to look at the statements with her. And so if there are issues in and around the accuracy of the statement, I would have thought, and the system that I push for, is that that all needs to be identified well in advance of the trial and issues in and around that resolved, in order that the complainer is properly prepared for any issues that might be raised in and around inconsistencies in her statement. And that's all about the process that I touched on before, that I very much pursued when I was an advocate deputy, which was meeting complainers in a very supportive environment, ensuring that they were prepared for court and that they were given all the necessary supports they need. And indeed, in cases that I've recently prosecuted, where their advocacy support worker has been with them, the rape complainer has sat in the room with the advocacy support worker and gone through her statement in a supportive way, in order that they're not on their own and that they're given the necessary support and advice in and around these issues. So that's how it should work. And if it's not been working in that way, I'm very disappointed. The difficulty, of course, is much of the criticisms within the material to the committee are anonymous and can't then be followed up by me or explored in detail. But following on my reading with the committee's, the evidence committee of these complainers, that is precisely something that I followed up directly with the Deputy Crown Agent and all of the Advocate Deputy team. And it wasn't something that I didn't react to immediately. And so all I can say is what should happen, what I have done in response to reading the evidence from the committee, and what we really are trying to do in driving through improvements with the review that I've asked for and the increased level of training to advocate deputies and procure fiscals in and around the expertise that's needed for these cases.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't know whether Mr. Harvey wants to come in if he's available.
Thank you, convener. Forgive me, I was offline there for an extended period with a connection issue. So my apologies, I missed the question.
I was sort of touching upon our evidence session with the survivors, and there was a really strong criticism over the process, not just from the crime prosecution, but police as well. And in terms of giving statements, the interaction or the lack of interaction from the actual advocate deputy. And it was really just to see if you feel that, is that kind of, you know, in terms of the delays and, you know, the years and the backlog and whatnot, if, you know, that's standard practice, and if so, why, and what can we do to try and rectify that?
So it's certainly not best practice is where I would start, I agree entirely with the points that I heard the Lord Advocate make once I was reconnected. I suppose that what I would probably add is just a little bit of context in relation to where we are. So the VIA staff in particular, but case preparers and those involved in contact with victims are seeking to deliver to those standards against a reality, as we've said, where things are taking longer. There are more cases than there were simply because of the backlog which has built up. And there's also, as a result of all that and an unintended consequence of the recovery, frankly, greater uncertainty as to when, for example, cases will call. And I think that that was part of the evidence session that you heard as well, and around the anxieties and the uncertainties about floating trials, et cetera, et cetera. So the net effect of all of that is that individual interactions with victims are taking longer, and there are more of them, simply because of all of these various uncertainties and also because of scale. So I agree entirely with all the points that Lord Advocate has made. The other point that I would add is that during periods where, for example, our public counters were closed, it was not possible often to meet with complainers in circumstances where it would be helpful to them to be able to look at their statement. So in some instances, suboptimally, we were using Teams for that on occasion. But that's, I suppose, an indication of the efforts that were being made to try and ensure, notwithstanding the difficult circumstances that we've found ourselves in at different stages, that we are in a position to try and make good progress with the provision of information and those discussions which the Lord Advocate has talked about in preparing for cases. So I suppose I'm adding context in terms of scale, context in terms of uncertainty, and context in terms of mitigations that have had to be taken in the context of lockdowns in order to try and progress these things, whilst in no way taking away from the experience that individuals have had, nor indeed disagreeing in any way with the Lord Advocate's points about how things ought to be conducted.
Okay, can I just come back to Lord Advocate, really, and it's a question about who provides the complainers with legal advice at present, and really just your views really on whether victims of sexual assault and domestic abuse should have access to independent legal representation as well?
So I think that's a very good question, because the Crown Office and Prosecutor Fiscal Service doesn't provide legal advice to a complainer. We are not the complainer's lawyers. And I also think it's really important that we understand that nowadays there has to be an enormous cultural shift in an understanding of how sexual crimes are prosecuted, in the sense that it's no longer a two-dimensional process in that it's Crown and Defence. The victims of sexual crime have legally enforceable rights. They have rights under the Convention, and they have rights that are recognised under the Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act. And we have to recognise that they have a voice. They have a right to information, a right to effective participation in the process. And they have a right to be informed about, for example, applications to lead evidence of previous sexual behaviour in court in relation to their case. So these are all difficult issues. These are all issues in and around sexual behaviour and previous sexual conduct are all very difficult. But the Crown can't give independent legal advice to a complainer in a case. And it really would have to be an independent lawyer who would be able to give that independent legal advice. The Crown can and does, through victim information and advice, and through lawyers working within the system, give advice to complainers about particular issues. But it's not independent advice, and we're not their lawyers. And so we are restricted in what we can say and what we can do. And so I think the time has come for recognition that there should be independent legal representation for victims of sexual crime, because of all the issues that we're talking about, the complicated nature of the subject matter, the impact on victims, and the challenges that the system provides. So I support that, and I support it particularly in the way that Lady Dorian's review has, which is for independent legal representation in around section 274, 275 applications, because it's important to understand that that process of itself engages a victim's rights under Article 8 of the Convention, and they have rights that are enforceable in that regard. I should also say one other thing, though, in relation to independent legal representation, it's this. There has been for some time now legal aid available, non-means tested, for victims of sexual crime and victims of domestic violence in relation to recovery of their medical records that would allow them to get independent legal representation where an application is made to the court for recovery of their personal and sensitive records. The law recognises in Scotland that such a complainer in a case of that nature can get legal representation, can be heard through her own lawyer in the court process, and can and is entitled to non-means tested legal aid for that application and advice. The tragedy is that I understand through the memorandum of understanding that I have with Rape Crisis, who provide me with information in order to assist in the way that we deal with these cases, is that often women are turned away by the legal profession who don't seem to understand that legal aid is available, and indeed legal representation and the right to be heard in these applications is available for the complainers at that stage. So the law has moved on significantly. A case of WF against the Scottish ministers set the law for the right to be heard in relation to sensitive records. The government of the day reacted to that and provided those women with non-means tested legal aid to ensure that they could have lawyers representing them. But the outcome isn't quite as predicted, in the sense that there's not a real understanding that that is currently available. And it goes back to what I said before, is that there has to be a cultural shift, an understanding that it's not two-dimensional, it's three-dimensional. And victims of crime have legal rights underpinned by the Victims Directive, enshrined in Scottish law and enshrined in the Convention of Human Rights. And we just have to alter our thinking in relation to these cases.
Okay, thanks very much. That was really, really interesting. I don't know if Mr. Harvey wants to come in. If not, then I'm happy to hand back over to the convener. Thanks.
Mr. Harvey, if you would like to come in, and then I will have to move us on. I'm just very conscious. Over to you, and then I'll actually bring in Rona Mackay, just to follow up on her original question when she dropped out. So, Mr. Harvey.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose it was just to pick up on that legal aid point and the availability of legal aid. So again, as part of system response, we have been seeking to promote and highlight that point with the Law Society and the Legal Aid Board to ensure that practitioners are well aware of the availability of those provisions in terms of being able to secure non-means tested funding for assisting individuals in those circumstances. And I suppose just the other point is just in relation to the Lord Justice Clerk's review and the potential benefits of that independent legal representation, which Lord Advocate has discussed. There is absolutely no doubt from the evidence that you've heard in the private session, but frankly, something that we have heard repeatedly over a number of years, that there is an understandable combination of misunderstanding and frustration on the part of victims about their perception of the Crown role, and a sense of dissatisfaction when they appreciate the true nature of the Crown role, and that is not necessarily the same as they would expect it to be in terms of, in many instances, representation of their interests, as opposed to the Crown's position in representing the broader public interest. So, frankly, not only would it be of a great assistance to those individuals, but it would also, frankly, be of great system benefit, enabling prosecutors to focus on assessment of public interest and advocating on that part, whilst giving a support and clarity and advocacy rights those victims in the context of applications for material and also in the context of Section 2700, 275 applications.
Thanks very much, Mr. Harvey. I'll hand back to Rona Mackay, who we lost, just to pick up on her previous line of questions, and then I'll hand on to Pauline McNeill. So, Rona.
Thank you, convener, and apologies, I did lose connectivity. I just wanted to come back on the second part of the question and ask the Lord Advocate if you could expand a bit on her saying that we need to be properly informed about judges, what that actually means, and also in that context, would you support a register of judicial interests?
So what I meant about being properly informed about judges is that I was saying we need to be properly informed about what the role of the judge is in the determination of cases of this nature, and indeed of very sensitive cases throughout the whole of our system of justice in Scotland. We have a judiciary that's appointed through an open, transparent process and through the Judicial Appointments Board, and we have a judiciary who are subject to their own professional rules and responsibilities. They are professional judges who judge. And my point that I was making was the criticism that's levied against Lady Dorian's recommendation for a pilot for judge-only trials is that judges don't represent democratic society. Judges aren't reflective of society. They're white, middle-aged, affluent, university-educated individuals who won't return convictions in the way, or acquittals in the way that the current system does, which is properly informed by a jury system. So my point is that we should look at what judges actually do, and is that criticism of the judge fair against the background of what judges in Scotland are known to do day and daily in the work that they undertake? And we know that in England and Wales, and indeed in Scotland, thousands and thousands of criminal cases are heard before members of the judiciary on their own, and there's no criticism of that process. The Magistrates Court in England and Wales hears cases without juries, as do the Crown Court in England and Wales in certain cases. And the Sheriff Court hears many cases of a sexual nature and in relation to summary crime without a jury across the country day and daily, without any criticism of the process. Judges sit in the Court of Session and deal with very difficult, sensitive cases that require very difficult decisions to be made, and there's no criticism made of the fairness of that process. So I think if we're to have a balanced debate about the issues that the suggestions in Lady Dorian's review give rise to, we need to properly understand what judges do, and we need to properly understand whether or not we can just dismiss the judiciary as being the appropriate trier of fact in sexual offence cases, as opposed to only ever being suitable for trial by jury. That was the point that I was getting at. And I've forgotten your other point, Ms. Mackay, I'm sorry.
It was would you support a register of judicial interests?
I think that's really not a matter for me to comment on as the independent head of the prosecution system. That's a matter for others, Ms. Mackay. But what I support is a debate over an issue that is eroding public confidence in the prosecution of a particular type of crime. I'd like a debate. I'd like to see the recommendations of Lady Dorian's review just looked at with a careful and balanced, in a careful and balanced way. And I support the review for that reason and for the reasons I've given before.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Thanks very much. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much. I'll hand on to Pauline McNeill now, and then I'll bring in Jane. Pauline.
Thank you very much, convener. Good morning, Lord Advocate and Crown Agent. I'm really interested in the line of questioning that Colette Stevenson started off with and your answer regarding independent legal advice. I think this is a critical area for the committee to look at, and I know that you've said there already is at the right to be heard on a section 274, 275 application where it relates to medical records. So my questions really relate to that. Firstly, Lord Advocate, do you think that the right to be heard should be wider than simply medical records? Because an application to use evidence of sexual history at these preliminary diets, you'd have thought the complainer should have an interest in the whole of the application and not just medical records. I was wondered if you thought it should, the right to be heard should be wider than simply medical records.
So I think that currently the right to be heard is available in the pre-trial process or in the process that's called in connection with the criminal procedure. And that relates to the recovery of personal and private records. And so Ms. McNeill, you've got that spot on. That right to be heard is available now. And that was confirmed in WEF against the Scottish ministers and is in statutory form. And we know that complainers are entitled to be heard then on these applications for recovery. The application for 274, 275 that relates to the lines of cross-examination that an accused person wishes to lead at trial is a very, very sensitive issue for complainers in these cases. And it can be such that it's so troubling and so profoundly impactful that they find it very, very difficult to cope with, even just knowing that this application has been made. Because you can understand they're awaiting trial and they're awaiting their trial, and then it's the first real contact that they have in order to understand what lines of cross-examination will be led against them and what attack may be made on their character and what evidence might be led of previous sexual conduct. So it's a very sensitive point in the case. And what we understand is that there's different complainers deal with these issues very differently. Each have very different vulnerabilities. And it's important that we identify the nature of these and the support that's required before we actually embark on the process of telling them that the application's made, explaining what the contents of it are, and whether or not we think it would be granted or not granted by the judge at first instance. You can understand that's a really important conversation, one that needs to be done with great care and support and sensitivity. And currently, the Crown do that through contact with VIA and through contact with other representatives of the Fiscal Service and lawyers of the service. We have engaged in discussions with Rape Crisis about that, and we have a very good guidance in and around how an approach is made to a complainer about a 275 application. And indeed, that was informed by Rape Crisis recently, and the guidance has recently been updated. But you'll see it's an issue, and it's important because it's the 275 process engages the complainer's legal rights under Article 8. So they have to be told about the application, and their views have to be taken and reported to the court. Now, currently, you'll appreciate what Mr. Harvey and myself have said. We are not the complainer's lawyers. There's a restriction on what we can do and a restriction about the context within which we meet and discuss these matters. So I would have thought the benefit of independent legal advice in and around probably what is one of the most sensitive issues in the case would be entirely beneficial for a vulnerable complainer who's being contacted about what is probably one of the most difficult issues in the trial process. And what that would mean from Lady Dorian's review is that the independent legal representation would involve giving advice and giving legal advice, but also being able to make submissions on behalf of the complainer in court on her behalf, in order that the court can be properly informed as to how to balance the competing rights in a case of this nature between the rights of the accused, the rights of the complainer, and to properly apply the statutory test under the Criminal Procedures Scotland Act. So I see great benefit in what Lady Dorian's review has recommended, and I see enormous benefit in the Parliament discussing that and considering that, and indeed the government consulting on that issue. I think Mr. Harvey, who is part of the review, might just quickly come in on that, Ms. McNeill, in case I've not covered it all off.
Mr. Harvey, would you like to come in? And if I can ask Lord Advocate, if, just in the spirit of time, and we've still got a few areas of questioning that we'd like to cover off, if you can keep your answers fairly brief. Mr. Harvey.
Thank you, Convener. I will keep this answer as brief as I can. So just picking up on that point about the obvious complexity and sensitivity of these issues, I suppose the other point that I would add is that the current statutory framework requires a notice of one of these applications 7 days before a preliminary hearing. In other words, the types of contact, the types of discussion can be in very compressed timescales, which in itself is something that, as part of a package, if this is being reviewed, I think is something that, again, as I'm sure all members will appreciate, in light of the potential content of these applications, the need to ensure that they are approached sensitively, the need to ensure that there is appropriate time to reflect, the need to ensure that there is appropriate time to seek advice, if that's the line that the members are minded to go down, which I would commend, then the current 7-day timescales for all of that are frankly unrealistic.
Thanks very much. Back to you, Pauline.
Yeah, I mean, these are really helpful answers. So it's clear to me that if we want to pursue this, there's quite a bit of work to be done on this to strengthen this right to be heard, which I do agree with the Lord Advocate on. And so the question is, how do we make that happen both in legislation? I noticed the Lord Advocate said that women are turned away, so there's work to be done in terms of the legal profession. And my only remaining question, just given the shortage of time, County Agent, is I take it if we legislated and created this right, albeit you said there's issues with the timescale, for the complainer to be fully represented at a preliminary trial where sexual history evidence is asked for, can I presume or can I ask you that the Crown itself would have no objection to dealing with what effectively is a third party representing the complainer? So you'd be satisfied as the Crown Agent that you would be able to and be happy to deal with the third party on this?
Thank you, Ms McNeill. The answer is yes. Again, referring to the Lord Justice Clerk's review, of which I was a member, paragraphs 443 and 444 cover this, and I would commend those to members. You will see that if we were to go down this line, we wouldn't be trailblazers, that it's happening in other common law jurisdictions, and positive research has been produced, which concluded that the provision had two important benefits. One, it allowed the prosecutor to focus on the application purely in terms of its significance for the prosecution, and two, it ensured that complainers could be satisfied that their views were heard by the court deciding the application. Such benefits would apply equally in Scotland, reducing almost entirely the tension between Crown and complainer discussed above. So, for all the reasons that are discussed in the report, the answer is yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to hand over to Jamie Green now, but before I do so, I'm able to extend the session this morning just beyond 11:30, but if I can, I know these are really interesting topics we're looking at, but if I can ask for responses, Lord Advocate and Mr Harvey, to be as succinct as possible. Over to you, Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. I'll try and keep my question succinct. In 2018, the Inspectorate of Prosecutions did a thematic report on the victim's right to review. Last year, there were nearly 34,000 cases where the Crown Office either discontinued prosecution or decided not to prosecute a case in the first place. Can I ask what percentage of those complainants were notified of that decision? How were they notified? And why are less than 1% of victims applying for a review to a decision not to prosecute or continue a case? That's a question for the Lord Advocate.
Yeah, I hope that I'm still heard. I had a problem there with my connectivity. You can hear me, Mr. Green, thank you. I actually think the Crown Agent's in a far better position than I am to give these sort of figures. Now, it might be that we can't give all of them today, but we're happy to follow that up in a letter. Crown Agent, do you think you have a bit more information than I do?
Thank you, Lord Advocate. Yes, happy to follow that up in writing. The numbers of discontinuations that you refer to, just for the avoidance of doubt, don't relate specifically to cases involving the main topic of discussion today. I think that I'm right in saying, Mr. Green, correct me if I'm wrong, that those are figures that relate to the overall proportion of prosecutorial decision making, both at first instance and discontinuation, and so might involve a whole range of different offences, many of which might not involve any complainer or victim at their heart. Separately, there are provisions in place at the moment in relation to intimation, and those do not yet fully extend to all cases. And I think we've previously written to the committee, but happy to do so again, in terms of the work that we're doing to seek to explore how we could extend that. And I'm conscious also that that's something that is in Mr. Green's bill.
I appreciate that. Thank you, Crown Agent. I wanted to flag it because the review was quite clear in its recommendation that it felt that all victims should be notified of a decision and also offered what options of remedy are available to them should they wish to apply for a review, and the numbers I think speak for themselves, but I look forward to more detail from the Crown on that. And my second question is that around the issue of the Murov doctrine, which is very relevant to many of the cases we're talking about today. We took some compelling evidence in our private sessions, and I won't go into great detail, from victims of these types of crime who felt that this was perhaps a misunderstood practice. And felt that either they misunderstood the implications of that type of prosecution, and also they felt that perhaps juries misunderstood the consequences of the decisions as well. And I think that is well documented in the public paper that we produced. I wondered if either the Lord Advocate or the Crown Agent might comment on what measures the Crown are taking to improve communication around Murov as practice, and whether they felt it actually was an appropriate and successful measure. Metric of prosecuting people with very complex and multiple circumstances.
Yes, so perhaps I could start, Mr. Green, by explaining the Murov doctrine is a very important doctrine of evidence in Scots law, and it's very important to the prosecution of sexual offences in Scots law. As you will be aware, and all the members of the committee will be aware, in order to have sufficient evidence in relation to any charge in Scots law, you have to have corroboration. And corroboration is evidence that supports or confirms, in a sexual case, the complainer's account. In relation to that, quite often you'd have the account of the complainer, DNA evidence, some eyewitness evidence, some evidence of distress, and the combination of these elements of evidence means that you would have sufficient evidence in law, you would have corroboration, so you would have a basis upon which to take the prosecution. The Murov doctrine is an exception to the rule of corroboration. The Murov doctrine means that you could have the evidence of one complainer speaking to a sexual assault against her in relation to the accused, and her case is corroborated not by independent evidence, but by the evidence of another complainer speaking to sexual assault by the same accused in similar circumstances that demonstrate that the accused is responsible and guilty of a course of conduct. And in that way, you can have the evidence of two individual witnesses, two individual complainers of sexual assault that corroborate each other. They're mutually corroborative. And so you would have sufficient evidence to go to a jury, ask a jury to return a conviction against the accused in relation to both complainers. Each complainer supports the other. The difficulties arise where you have a case, for example, I think it's in the documented in the report from the committee, where you have two complainers and the jury reject one complainer but believe another. The difficulty is that in law for that other complainer, there's not been corroborated evidence, so there's not a basis in law to convict. That's what I think was the description given by one of the women who spoke to the committee in such compelling terms. And I see what the committee said, that it was pretty shocking and upsetting and disturbing to hear that it was a conviction for rape, but it couldn't be returned because of the way in which the jury had understood the operation of the Murov doctrine. They plainly hadn't understood it, because in that case it must have been that the only way that you could corroborate complainer one is if you believe complainer two, and the only way that you could corroborate complainer two is if you believed one, and that would be the only basis upon which you would be able to return the conviction. So what we can identify from that situation that the committee heard about is that the jury plainly haven't understood the directions, the legal directions. And in a way, that's not unsurprising, because it's quite complex and the law on corroboration is complex. I think that what the Crown can do is to make as much use as they can of the rules of evidence to bring forward these prosecutions. And the Crown do all that they can to use the Murov doctrine, to develop the law in and around the Murov doctrine, to push the boundaries of that, to try and secure convictions in these cases where otherwise we wouldn't be able to, because we don't have corroboration. That's what we can do in and around the Murov doctrine. And I suppose it might be worthwhile thinking about whether or not the directions given to the jury, as Lady Dorian was discussing in her review, are appropriate, are adequate, and are properly reflecting the law that the jury needs to apply. That's how I see the how I feel that I can answer that question, Mr. Green.
Thank you, that was very helpful. It does, thank you.
Thanks very much. If that's all your questions, Jamie, I'd like to move on now to another area around communication, and I'll bring in Russell Findlay, followed by Pauline McNeill. So, Russell, over to you.
Hi, thank you. So, a few weeks ago, my colleague Jamie Green and I met with some of your Crown Office colleagues who prosecute in the lower courts. We discussed an issue that isn't often really talked about, and that was plea deals. There's one particular case I am familiar with in which a serious domestic violence case had 16 charges that after 4 years was pled to drop 7 and amend some of the others. The victim wasn't informed of this decision, and some of the details that were amended were quite jarring and I suppose re-victimised in some respects. Now, there's two points to this question. One is, should victims be told when plea deals take place and the details about them? And secondly, given the court backlog, is there not a risk that these are going to be used more than they are currently, and perhaps disproportionately so, to the detriment of justice? What safeguards are there against that happening?
So, Mr. Findlay, I will follow up the issue that you've raised about that particular case. I think it was with Mr. Logue that you met, John Logue, is that right?
Yes.
Yes. So I will follow up that particular case, because
it's a historic case. It's just, I mention it as an example, but I don't suppose there's much purpose in revisiting it. But I just mention it to give people, I suppose, an idea of what does happen.
All right. So all I can speak to is the practice that I understand should take place in relation to these cases, which is that if there is a plea on offer from the accused, that what happens is Prosecutor Fiscal Deputy, or indeed the Advocate Deputy, discusses that with the Defence Counsel or Defence Agent and decides whether or not, on the basis of the evidence and in the public interest, the plea that's on offer is acceptable. It might be that some of the detail of the plea the complainer doesn't understand or doesn't approve of, but what I understand should happen, and I always did, and I understand the standing instructions to all lawyers within the services, that there is a discussion with the witness about the plea, with the complainer about the plea, and they're told what the detail of that is and the basis upon which it's, accepted, and the reason and rationale for that. I'm disappointed to hear that in a case that you know of, that that didn't happen. That shouldn't happen, because it's imperative that victims are told about plea deals in their case at the time, before they hear it in court, and it's done in a sensitive and supportive way. And that's what I have always done, and that's what I expect to be done. And if it hasn't happened, I will make efforts again after today to reinforce that instruction that's service-wide, and an instruction to the Advocate Deputy Team. In relation to the temptation to do a plea deal because of the backlog, I think that's what you're hinting at, Mr. Finlay, that there might be a temptation on the part of the prosecutors to say, we'll just take a soft plea in order to get through this backlog. I just reject that that would be a temptation for any prosecutor prosecuting the public interest. It's certainly not an approach that I would give any support to whatsoever. The difficulties with the backlog remain, as I said in my first evidence session, political solution. And we have a responsibility, a moral responsibility, to look again, fresh, at where we are with the backlog. And we need to look at remedies to that. But it cannot be that soft justice is the answer, and I certainly don't support that. I wonder if the Crown Agent could come in, because he will be with a better position in terms of the overall service approach. Agent?
Thank you,
Mr. Hardley, do you want to briefly add something?
I will be brief, convener. Crown policy has not changed in light of the pandemic in relation to this as the first point. There have been calls from various individuals within and out with the system that in some way the Crown should take some sort of wholesale approach in terms of trying to resolve the backlog. That's rejected. That will not be the approach, and individual cases continue to be assessed in terms of individual public interest. And I suppose just picking up on the initial case which prompted the question, and appreciating Mr. Finlay's comment that it's now historic, but for the avoidance of doubt, since this is a public hearing, there are complaints handling procedures that are available to all members of the public. And if there are situations which give rise to the kinds of concerns that Mr. Finlay has alluded to, then we would want to hear about them. And I would encourage people to look at the material available online as to how those complaints can be made, and they will be acted upon.
Thank you. I mean, I'm reassured by the commitment from you both that going forward, the plea deals will only be taken in the public interest and in the interest of justice. But the case I referenced wasn't unusual, and from the conversation I had with your colleagues who prosecuted in the lower courts, my understanding was there wasn't the mechanism to routinely inform complainers about plea deals, just perhaps through volume of work. It may be that the Lord Advocate in her day, when she was prosecuting the higher courts, that was more likely, because she was perhaps prosecuting fewer cases, albeit more serious ones. But again, thank you for your answers.
Thanks very much, Russell. And I'll hand over to Pauline before we move on to our next area of questioning. Pauline.
Thank you, so there's been a suggestion that a single point of contact, the complainer, might be, I think Lady Dorian herself says that in the report, might reduce the scope for complaints around communication. So that's sort of my question. I mean, do you think it's practical to do this? And I just wondered what would then be the relationship between that and Victim Support Scotland? Because I must say, when I was listening to the evidence and that, I won't go through all the testimony, but we've had lots of failures of communication. So this would be a way of solving it. But I just wondered, do you think it's practical to do this? Who would do it? I kind of thought that's what Victim Support did, but maybe they don't have the capacity to contact the police and the Crown. And, anyone's ever tried to, well, it's not a complaint, I can't just lift the phone, that's the problem, isn't it? And ask the fiscal what's going on, probably wouldn't even know where to find the number. So somebody has to do that for them. I just wondered who you think should do it and is it practical to do this? Thank you very much.
So I think, Ms McNeill, again, this is probably something that the Crown Agent could give you more detail on. I know that Leslie Thompson, QC General, produced a report on and around all of this, recommending a single point of contact. One can see the sense of that, that there's one single point of contact that gives you all of the information throughout the history and journey of your case. And that means that you have consistency in your advice and confidence in the system that's giving you the information for your case. It just stands to good sense that that would be the way forward. I think there is work being done in and around that that the Crown Agent can come back on, and how that links in with the Crown Office's victims and information advice. I think he's better placed to explain the strategic arrangement that that would require.
Thanks very much.
Mr. Harvey, do you want to come in with anything additional?
Please, Convener. I suppose I might look back once again to the theme of the day of the Lord Justice Clerk's review. Members, if on careful reading, will really note that there are three elements in this area. There's the single point of contact, there's the advocacy, and there's the independent legal representation, all of which I would respectfully suggest are gaps in the system that are leading to many of the frustrations that you've heard about during the various evidence sessions. Insofar as the single point of contact is concerned, Lord Advocate's correct that and members, again, if they were part of previous committees, may recall previous discussions about the Thompson review, the recommendations that were therein, and the work that was then taken forward by the Victim Task Force. That work is ongoing. It's led by Victim Support Scotland, with support from Scottish Government and support by all justice organisations, including COPFS. That's still at the design phase. We entirely support the work that's going on there. All I would say is that when one looks at single point of contact, when one looks at advocacy services, and when one looks at independent legal representation, given that none of those three things exist, that is further investment in the system, is what I would say. And therefore, a consideration will have to be given to that in terms of not only legislative vehicles, but also organisational structures and budgets.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Pauline. I'm going to move on now to some questioning around use of pre-recorded evidence and culture issues, and I'll bring in Fulton. Fulton, over to you.
Thanks, Convener. I've got a question for the Lord Advocate, and it's around something that we heard in our private sessions, the private testimony we heard from survivors around culture and within the Crown Office. And I think that's about the example that we heard, was about the advocate deputies acting like they were part of an old boys club and being friendly with the Defence Council. Now, I think we can all understand how that might come across, because people will know each other in defence. Defence lawyers will know advocate deputies and such like. I'm just wondering, though, is this something that the Crown Agent and the Lord Advocate recognise, and is it something that's a cultural issue that could perhaps be addressed if it is indeed recognised?
So, Mr. McGregor, can I just be clear about what the criticism was, that a complainer in a sexual offence case considered that the advocate depute in the High Court was too close to the defence and looked as though they were friends and part of what seemed to be an inappropriate relationship, or too close, or I just want to understand?
I think that's a good summary, and we know that the people who are victims and who are having to present at court, it's a very, very difficult time for them. But you know that this particular person's that was their experience, and they were quite definite on it. So I just wondered if that was something that, you know, was that a one-off, or was it, is it something that you recognise as being an issue? Because obviously these people will have professional relationships, and you know, there's no getting away from that as well. But that can then, you know, look like something else to somebody going through such a traumatic experience.
I completely agree with you that it would be very upsetting to a complainer in a sexual offence case if she was in court in relation to her case, she considered that the prosecutor was behaving in a way that was inappropriate and demonstrated to her and to her eyes that they were overly friendly and part of what you describe as a boys' club. That's just entirely inappropriate and inconsistent with anything that I believe in. A prosecutor in the High Court, and indeed any other court, has to be respectful of all the individuals who appear in the court, the judge, defence counsel, the accused and the complainer. And you have to behave with appropriate professionalism, and you have to give each and every one of these individuals respect. And you have to recognise that for a complainer in that situation, they feel very vulnerable, they feel exposed, and they're looking, all they're looking for is justice. And that sort of conduct, as described, is inconsistent with the way in which I consider cases should be prosecuted. And I'm deeply upset to hear about that. And it's not something I recognise. But we are not immune to criticism, and we are open to self-reflection. And I have, as I say, appointed Suzanne Tanner QC to do a review. And as part of that review, we will be examining our own conduct, our own engagement with complainers, because it is an aspect of humanity that we deal with these people respectfully, properly, and they feel that justice is being done in their case.
Thank you for that, Lord Advocate. Thank you for that very definite and strong response. And I think that the individual who took time out to come and speak to the committee privately, if she's watching this or watches at some point in the future, I hope that she will be pleased with that pretty strong response from you. Convener, I think there's something in the chat about David wanting in.
Yeah, I'll bring in David. Mr. Harvey, do you want to come in on that?
Sorry, no convener, not on that one. I don't, nothing to add to that one.
Okay, sorry, that may be my fault. I might have misread the chat there, convener. Yeah, I've got a second question as well, if that's okay, convener. I know we are tight in time, but it's on statements and the taking of statements. And I know that this has already been discussed, and Lord Advocate's already given a good overview on this, but on the introduction of pre-recorded complainers' evidence in serious sexual assault cases, I'm wondering, are there any barriers just now to introducing this service quickly? And I also wonder if these could be extended for domestic abuse cases, and wondering if the Lord Advocate can reiterate our plans on that area. And that will be me, convener.
So in relation to recorded statements, there's a pilot to visually record the statements of complainers in rape cases taking place in a number of jurisdictions that the Crown Agent will tell us about, but I think we're yet to hear about the outcome of that pilot. I'm not sure what the situation is to domestic violence cases, but there is a recognised in Lady Dorian's review benefits from evidence being taken on commission. And that means that the evidence is captured before the trial, so that a complainer evidence is recorded and they don't need to wait for the trial to come to court. I have to say that in and around all of that, Mr. McGregor, there are some issues. And while we're working along with Lady Dorian's review, while we're seeking to implement those parts that can be implemented without legislation, there is a push for evidence being taken on commission. And as Lord Advocate, and having spoken to a number of prosecutors in these cases, I think that from my perspective, I would like to see just how impactful pre-recorded evidence is in terms of securing a conviction or otherwise. We're at very early days with evidence being recorded on computer. And I think we need to be careful about a wholesale adoption of that. And I say that because sometimes the prosecutors I work with and I support tell me that they're anxious about the impact of the evidence in court, in a live court, and the question whether or not a recorded evidence is as impactful as live evidence. That's one question we need to explore. I've also had situations where I've met victims of sexual violence who've told me that they felt disengaged by the process, that they felt that they'd wished that they'd gone into court with a screen. And whilst they chose to give evidence remotely through CCTV, they found that they didn't enjoy that and they felt disconnected by the process. And they felt that perhaps they didn't come across as well as they should. I just repeat what victims of crime tell me. But I also know that there's some benefits in pre-recorded evidence in terms of commissions, because it means that victims don't have to wait ages to give their evidence in court, and they don't have to put up with constant adjournments of the cases before they're actually called to give evidence, which is a feature currently of the system that we have. Because of the backlog, because of the number of cases in the system, cases are repeatedly adjourned before the witness actually gets to come into court or give their evidence remotely. So it's not a straightforward black and white issue. And I think that we need to take care to revisit all of this issue in a reasonable period of time. Perhaps a Crown agent could tell you about recording in domestic abuse cases. I just don't know the answer to that just now.
Thank you, Lord Advocate. Fulton, if that's your line of questioning finished, I think, Mr. Harvey, do you want to come in? And then I will bring in Pauline McNeill and Russell Finlay, who are both interested in asking supplementary questions on this. So, Mr. Harvey?
So, perhaps given the time available, I can follow up in writing in more detail, but the headline is in relation to summary cases evidenced by commission is not used at present, and the video recorded interview process that I referred previously to in pilot, again, tends to be those at the higher end in terms of allegations. In this context, particularly in relation to those cases likely to end up as summary prosecutions, perhaps the discussion and correspondence and any future discussions might want to focus on the potential of body-worn cameras in this context.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. I'll bring in Pauline McNeill and then Russell Finlay. Pauline.
Thank you very much. I imagine one of the key issues about pre-recorded evidence, forgive me, I have not understood the process, is the cross-examination of the complainer in court. So I just wondered how does that get done then? Because I would imagine that the person standing trial, the lawyer, would want to put questions to the complainer. Is that done before, or is that done in court? It would be helpful to know. And would you be concerned about that? I mean, it's a concern I certainly have, and I just would like any answer you have to that. Thank you very much.
So I hope I can answer most of that, Ms. McNeill. So in relation to evidence that's a victim statement that's pre-recorded, that would be her evidence in chief, and that would be played either at a commission where cross-examination would then take place, or it's played in evidence in chief at the trial and cross-examination takes place at the trial. It might be that the victim gives evidence remotely or indeed they can be in court. But I think that there undoubtedly, in order to ensure a fair trial, there has to be an opportunity for the accused to cross-examine the witness. So pre-recorded evidence means that it can be used as evidence in chief, but the opportunity to cross-examine must remain, and it would depend the way in which the evidence was led at trial. I suspect if you've got evidence in chief recorded, that it would be done, the cross-examination would then be done on commission, and those recordings would be played to the jury at the trial.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Russell Finlay, over to you.
It's in a similar theme as in discussing support on for victims and witnesses. But I think in your opening remarks, Lord Advocate, you said you'd tasked Lindsay Miller to review the Crown's Victim Information and Advice Service. I suppose the question is, does its ability to help victims and witnesses not boil down entirely to decisions you make about your budget? In other words, you know, the primary function of the Crown is to prosecute crime, ergo that takes up by far the biggest slice of your budget. And given the chronic backlogs, funds for victim information will always be a secondary consideration. Do you agree with that? And if so, can anything be done about that?
Well, I don't know about the budget and the allocation to VR. Give me, as I say, only 6 months into this role. The Crown agent will be able to give you the chapter and verse on that, I'm sure, Mr. Finlay. We really want to ensure that VIA communicates effectively and timelessly with complainers, and that they do it in a supportive and sensitive way. Backlog has meant that each individual VIA officer has cases for far longer, and probably their individual caseload has increased by maybe 100%, perhaps even more. And so the challenges that the backlog brings is that VIA have got cases for longer, and they're finding it more and more challenging because of the immense emotional involvement that VIA requires to give to the support of individual complainers. But the fact that their cases are lasting for longer and there's anxiety in and around adjournments and delays, that it's making the job much, much more difficult. So, in a sense, some of the hidden issues of the backlog relate to people within the service who do distinct roles, and those that are involved with VIA at the coalface that are dealing with the difficulties that victims and witnesses have because of the backlog. Those are major challenges, and essentially that's part of the reason why we instructed Lindsay Miller to conduct the review. Perhaps the Crown Agent, though, could answer your point on the budget, Mr.
Thank you, Lord Advocate. Happy to provide further information. So, just picking up on the broader context point, so cases are taking longer. There are more of them. There is greater uncertainty as to when they will call. And there is the overall societal issue of greater uncertainty in terms of restrictions and a pandemic and availability of diets, etc., etc. Insofar as the impact that that is having on VIA and their caseloads, just by way of illustration, the most recent figures that we have indicate that the number of contacts, in other words, the number of times that VIA officers are in discussions with complainers, has increased by 92% since March of 2019. So that's obviously very significant. Coming back to the budgetary point, and bearing in mind that we are against a constantly moving picture in relation to the nature of the backlog, the nature of COVID variants and the implications that that has for the system, we have consciously increased the VIA staffing in the High Court, and continue to do so. I think on a previous occasion, when I spoke to the committee, I referenced the ongoing recruitment exercise. And so, insofar as High Court VIA is concerned, there will have been an increase of over 50% in that staffing capacity once those posts are filled. But you'll appreciate that even with that, and even with those projections and the budget that we got, there's a difference between 50% increase in staffing and 90% increase in demand in terms of contract. And the other point I would highlight is simply that the enhanced court programme, moving from 16 High Court trials to 20 High Court trials, whilst welcome in tackling the backlog, does by definition mean that more of those VE officers need to be, for want of a better phrase, court-facing, which is important in terms of the experience for those who are going through court at that particular moment in time, but increases the pressure on those who are seeking to support in relation to those cases that have yet to come to court. So that's why the review is necessary. It's a constantly moving picture. We have been planning in terms of mitigations. Steps have been taken, as you can see, in terms of the increase in staffing. But candidly, there's much more to do, which is why the review is necessary.
Mr. Finlay, do you want to come back in?
Please. Sorry, I just wanted a bit of clarification on the 92%. Mr. Harvey, I didn't quite know what that related to exactly.
So in terms of interactions with complainers, compared to March of 2019, just as a baseline, in other words, a pre-pandemic level, then the number of interactions that an individual VIA officer is having with complainers has increased by in excess of 90%.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed. Time is against us as usual. We were hoping to ask some further questions around the backlog of cases, but we will follow those up in writing. And may I also ask, Lord Advocate, you mentioned a review that Suzanne Tanners will be conducting. So it would be helpful for committee members to perhaps have some further details from you on the review, and also if we could maybe ask for you to write to us on completion of the review with some updated information, perhaps on any appropriate actions that are identified, that would be helpful. So in the meantime, can I thank both you, Lord Advocate, and Mr. Harvey for your time today. It's been most helpful. And as I say, if there are any questions that we've not asked today, we'll follow those up in writing. So that concludes the public part of the meeting. Our next meeting will be on Wednesday, the 12th of January 2022, when we expect to take oral evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans and witnesses from the Scottish Prison Service on the SSI entitled The Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Scotland Amendment Rules of 2021. Further details on that meeting will be available with the agenda and papers on our website in early January. So in closing, can I take this opportunity to thank all of those who have given oral and written evidence to the committee in 2021, and can I wish all members, staff, witnesses, members of the public a very safe and happy festive season and a very happy new year. Thank you very much, and we will now move into private session. Thank you.